Good morning, church family, and welcome to Mount Pisgah Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us for worship today. If you're here with us this morning, we're thankful for you. And if you're watching online, we're thankful that you've chosen to join with us this morning. I want to take just a moment and thank our church family for allowing us to be away today, my family and the Lindsay family, and just retreat and have a refresher time. We are worshiping with you via live stream this morning, and so we're excited about what God's going to do. I want to thank Danny Courson for being here this morning and preaching, and Larry for leading us in worship, and the rest of those on the band and musical team, as well as those in the sound booth. Again, thank you for joining us for worship. If you're visiting with us, we'd love for you to fill out one of our Connect cards so that we could get more information about you and be able to connect with you and get you some information about our church. If you're interested in doing that, you can head over to our website at www.mtpisgahchurch.net/connect. Fill out that little card and we'll be able to get you some more information. Also, if you're interested in giving this morning to further the kingdom of what God's called us to do in strengthening relationships with God, His church, and the world, we'd love to give you the opportunity to do that. There's a chest out in the foyer on the Welcome Center desk where you could drop a physical tithe in. If you're interested in giving online, you can do that at www.mtpisgahchurch.net/give, or you could also come by the church office one day or mail in a check, and we'll put that in with the offering and use that to further the kingdom that God's called us to do. Again, thank you so much for joining us this morning in worship, and I'm excited about what God's going to do. Let's worship the Lord together today. Well, good morning, church family, and welcome to...
with some scripture. We're going to be reading Psalm 33. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make the melody to him with the harp of the 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully of the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all the work is done in his faithfulness. He loves the righteousness and justice. And the earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their host. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He puts the deep in the storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke it, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen as his heritage. The Lord looks down from heaven. He sees all the children of man from where he sits enthroned and looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth. He who fashions the hearts of them all and observes all their deeds. The king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength. The war horse is a false hope for the salvation and by its great might it cannot be rescued. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, that he may deliver their soul from death and keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
Stand with us, please. Exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest.
Sing glory.
Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King. Your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Full of praise, be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise, be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Hearts full of praise, be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the
So today during intentional prayer time, we're going to pray for two different churches. And first, we're going to start off with Matt Boyd, who's the lead planting pastor at Sojourn Church in Portland, Oregon. And when we asked how we can pray for him, he said that it's been a really difficult year overall. And with COVID, it's been even more difficult for him. And so he just asked for prayer specifically for reaching his community and also keeping people well during the COVID-19 crisis. And then we're also going to pray for Craig Gilley, and he's the lead pastor at Happy Home Baptist Church in Leeds. And let's just pray for him to have moments this week to love his congregation well, and also pray for him to keep going even when it's extremely difficult, because things are not normal right now, y'all. And we really want to pray that all pastors keep up what they're doing because it's hard. It really is. So let's pray. God, thank you so much for giving us opportunities to pray for pastors all over our nation, but also right here in our home. God, I pray that we will just lift up Matt right now, and I pray that we will lift up Sojourn Church in Oregon. I pray that you will give him just opportunities to love his community. I pray that you will give him just encouragement to keep going, even when it's hard. God, I pray for Happy Home Baptist Church, and I pray for Craig Gilley. I pray for Leeds. I pray that you'll help him touch Leeds, and I pray that you will just give him opportunities to love his community well. God, help us to continue to love the people of Cropwell. Help us to continue to love the people here at Mount Pisgah, and help us to continue to just show your love to everyone, even when it's hard. In your name we pray, amen.
Beside my bed of my mom and dad who went to be with the Lord several years ago. You know, life gets real when we think of those that have gone before us, but it's great comfort and sure hope that we'll be reunited with our believers one day. You know, this is how it's going to happen. The scripture says, for the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and the trumpet of God shall sound. It said, the dead in Christ, my mom and dad, will rise first. Then ye which were alive and will remain shall be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. You know, our world today is upside down, but one of these days God's going to turn it right side up. Right side up. You going to be ready, as the preacher's going to preach, to fly away.
Some glad morning when this life is old, I'll fly away.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this sweet opportunity this morning to come into your house. We pray, Lord, that your name would be honored and glorified as we've sung. Dear Father, we pray that you'll put your words in Brother Danny's mouth, Lord, that he can speak a truth, that if those that are not ready, Lord, that today may be their day of salvation, that today you may help them get ready, Lord, as we are ready for the return of our Jesus Christ, our Lord. For it's in Christ's name we gather. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to be with y'all this morning at Mount Pisgah, and I appreciate Brother Chris Beck and the invitation to come and preach this morning. This is the first church I got to preach in when I came as the Associational Mission Strategist to St. Clair. So it's good to be back a year later. Did okay since he invited me back. But it's good to be with you. I appreciate your pastor and staff and all that they're doing. He said, these are difficult times. Churches are having to do all sorts of things to adjust and able to be able to minister. And we've had some churches who've taken, then had to back up because of the positive diagnosis of COVID-19. So just continue to pray for all 69 churches in St. Clair Baptist Association as they meet for worship, either online, through Zoom, or other forms of technology, the ones who can come together to meet on campus. It is challenging times, but the Word of God doesn't stop. So pray for your brothers and sisters as they continue to serve in the kingdom. This morning we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 12, beginning with verse 34. Luke chapter 12, looking at verses 34 through 48. And if you want to follow along in your Bible, I encourage you to turn there. But in order to set this up, the message is entitled, Are You Ready? Are You Ready? And what that means is, are you ready for the coming of the Lord? As we look at what's going on in our world today, I see all sorts of people. They're worried about COVID-19. They're worried because of riots and protests that are taking place not only in our nation, but all around the world. They're worried about the economy as jobs are disappearing. And it's not just here in our nation, but people around the world are concerned about the economic situation. We see tensions rising between different nations around the world, and we wonder, is this the end of time? Is Jesus going to come back soon? There's a lot of discussion among people about whether or not this is the time. Now, what do you think? Do you think that this is the time that Jesus is getting ready to come back? Do you think it could be soon? Could it be any day? Here's the most important thing. God never tells us to try to figure out when he's coming back. But in his word, over and over again, he does tell us to be ready for when he comes back. We shouldn't be so focused on when it's going to happen. We should be focused on the work he gave us to do until he comes back. So to explain this and to set this up, I want to think back when I was a child. As a child, I was the youngest of four kids. And when we were old enough that our parents felt they could go off and leave us alone without us killing each other or destroying the house, was when my mom and dad would go somewhere, and we would stay at home. But they always sat down with us before they left and gave us a set of instructions. There were some jobs to be done so that when they came back, those jobs would be completed. And as long as everything was completed when they came back, everything was fine. But if we didn't do the jobs they told us to do, then when they came back, it's what we call the day of reckoning. My dad had a paddle about this long. It was made out of wood. It was painted red and given the name Matilda. And Matilda lived in a closet hallway. And when Dad came home and things weren't the way he had told us they should be, he'd say, "Go get Matilda." And we had to go and get the paddle and bring it to him. And then he would explain to us what we did and why it was wrong, and then he would paddle us. Now, I don't know where you are on paddling for it or against it, but I tell you, I'm for it. My parents taught me some things that I needed to be taught, and sometimes it took a little pain to get the message through. But here's the situation. When they would give us those instructions, sometimes we were focused, we would jump right on the list of things to be done, and we'd get the work completed. And then there were some times when we'd get distracted, be it by TV, video games, phone calls, friends who came by, whatever. We got distracted, and so we didn't finish the work. And then still there are other times when we would procrastinate. Now, I want to tell you, I used to be an amateur procrastinator, but I became so good at it, I turned pro. And now I'm a procrastinator. It came as a child on into my life today. Procrastinate. We know what we're supposed to do, but we have a tendency to put those things off. So there were times that we kept saying, "We know Mom and Dad are coming back. We know we've got these things to do," but we just kept putting them off. And then the later it got and we realized that time is running out, we're not sure when they're coming back, but they are, and it may be any time now, we would panic and we would get frantic and we would start running all over the place trying to get the jobs completed before they got home. I think this passage of Scripture falls perfectly in line with that. Because as a church and as individual believers, there are some of us who know that Jesus is coming back, and because we are busy work, we are busy preaching and teaching and proclaiming the gospel, using every moment to fulfill his purposes. There are some of us who have been distracted by the cares and concerns of life, and we're more focused on the things that we enjoy in this world than we are about the work that God's given us to do. Matter of fact, we don't even think about the fact he's coming back because we're just living in the now and enjoying these moments. And then there are some of us who are starting to realize, I haven't been doing this work, and every moment that goes by, we're a step closer to his coming. And we're starting to get frantic and panicked and say, it is time for me to get serious and get busy about doing the work of God. So this morning, I want you to think, are you ready? Jesus returns. In verse 34 of Luke chapter 12, it says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Stay dressed for action and keep your lamps burning. Stay dressed for action and keep your lamps burning. You know, when I think of staying dressed for action, I think of several examples. First of all, I think of the pit crews for NASCAR. When a car pulls in for a pit stop, they long to do what they're supposed to do. There's no time for them to be sitting back in a rocking chair, not have on their fire suit, their helmets, their gloves, and all the things that they need. They've got to be on task, ready for that car to pull in, so that as soon as that car pulls in, they can jump and do their job. Can you imagine the driver pulling in and them going, hold on a minute. Hold on a minute. This one's got to get this thing. Just be patient. We'll be there in a few minutes. In the context of NASCAR, that doesn't work very well, does it? You know, I've been amazed how fire departments work. Firemen go to bed wearing certain parts of their uniform with other parts hanging up so that as soon as the alarm goes off, they can jump up, crawls, and they are on the way. It's because they are dressed and ready that these things happen so quickly. And then I think of a football player, especially a professional football player, who's getting paid to do this job. Can you imagine? The coach turns around and says, I need you in the game right now. And he doesn't have on his pads, and he doesn't have on his helmet, and he doesn't have on his cleats. And he goes, well, hold on just a few minutes. Give me a few minutes, and I'll be ready. That doesn't work. Those men are all called to be ready for the task right then, right there. And as we serve God, we are called to be ready for the task at all times. You never know when God's going to put someone in your path who needs to hear your testimony. Somebody in your path who needs to hear some encouragement. And the only Lord. I think of an example I heard years ago where one man made a statement in church. And he said, every morning when I get dressed, I put on the armor of God. First thing in the morning, I put on every piece of the armor of God. And a second man looked at him and said, why do you ever take it off? It comes to dwell within us. If you are a believer, you've prayed and put your faith and trust in Christ, and God has sent His Holy Spirit to dwell in. Is there any time when the Holy Spirit is not present with you? No. He's with you all the time. The spiritual armor that was spoken about in Scripture, are we not supposed to be ready at all times? We've got to have that armor of faith on all times so that we are always ready for every opportunity to speak good about the name of God. It goes on in the next verse and says, after keep your lamps burning, be like men who are waiting for their master to come home from the wedding feast so that they may open the door to him. And once he comes and knocks, at once when he comes and knocks, we are supposed to be alert and anticipating the coming of Christ, just as these servants would be alert awaiting their master to come back from his wedding. Now, I think it's important that we understand the wedding feast. This means that the owner, the manager, the one who's in charge of this property, the one who possesses it all, it's his wedding day. Do you think that'd be a special day for him? You think there's going to be a lot of money spent on a celebration? You think friends and family are going to be invited to the wedding? And then, as soon as the wedding feast is over, he's going to pick up his bride, he's going to walk to the house, and he's the door, patiently waiting for his servants to open the door and let him into his own to work. No, what it says is the wedding feast is a tremendous once-in-a-lifetime experience. And so those servants need to be eager. They need to be anticipating. They need to be waiting, knowing that at any time the master could be coming. They want to open the door. They don't want him to have to stand there and wait to come into his own home with his wife. They want everything to be ready. Church, when Jesus comes back, he is coming back for his bride, which means he's coming to get us for that great wedding feast. And we better be ready when he comes. We can't say, well, maybe he'll give us a little short notice and we can get ready. We have to be ready now. We have to be living our lives as though Jesus were coming back right now, and this may be our last opportunity to praise His name here on earth. This may be our last opportunity to glorify Him or share the gospel here on earth. So we better make the most of the time that we've been given. He goes on and says, "Blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes." Blessed are those servants the master finds awake when he comes. You know, that's not really a big requirement. Lord, what do you ask of me? Just stay awake. How about that? Think about the disciples who were in the garden with Jesus. Jesus went off to himself to pray, but he told the disciples to sit there and watch and pray. How much watching did they do when their eyes were closed? They went to sleep. Jesus tells us the same thing. I'm coming. You don't know when it's going to be, so you need to watch and pray. Watch what's going on. Be aware of the situation. Be aware of what's happening. Be aware that I'm coming back. And when it happens, that I do come again. Are we aware and are we prepared for the coming of Christ? You know, I think sometimes we get so used to our routines and our rituals and our habits, we forget that we serve a living Savior who is coming back for us. I wear a bracelet on my wrist all the time. It's 5 symbols to talk about the gospel. Oh, there's an arrow that points up. Then there's an arrow that, well, here, let me just pull it off and show it to you. There's an arrow that points down. It's a tomb, then there's an arrow that points up and an arrow that points down. And the significance of this bracelet is simply 5 things. Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, Jesus ascended, and the last one, back. Those are the 5 points of the gospel. Now think about this. It happened, right? He died, it already happened, right? Rose from the already happened. Father, it's happened. What remains of that gospel to be fulfilled? Step 5, he's coming back. Church, do you believe he's coming back? Are you living today as though he could be coming back today? That's where we've got to be as followers of Christ. Jesus said, verse 37, "Truly I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at the table, and he will come and serve them." For those believers who are active in their faith, who are putting their trust in Christ, who are anticipating his return, who are ready for his return, it says when he comes, he's going to reverse the roles. And he is going to serve us. Picture Jesus when he washed the disciples. Is that not such a humbling experience? Said, no, you can't wash my feet. You can't do that. And what did Jesus say? If you don't, you're part of me. Jesus says, serve me all. Do the things I've told you. And when I come back for you, I'm coming back for you as my bride. And as my bride, I'm going to love you, I'm going to care for you, I'm going to provide for you, and I'm always going to be there with you. You're in this world and you're having to go through some tough times. You're having to go through some difficulties. My spirit is with you, but you're still living in a world of sin. I'm coming to take you away from all that. I'm coming to take you to a place where there's no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more pain. It's all rejoicing. All praise and glory to the honor of God in his presence and in his kingdom. And then it says in verse 38, if he comes in the second watch or in the third and finds them awake, blessed are those servants. The second watch and the third watch in the night. Can y'all hear this? Now? All right. Sorry for the interruption, but that's how the devil works. Anytime he can get us off task. So let's not lose focus. In verse 39, it says, "But know this, that if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have left his house to be broken into." All my years as a Christian, I have heard people time after time try to predict when Jesus is coming back. And one of the best examples I remember was the first church I served was in Gadsden, Alabama. And somebody in that area came out with a book called 88 Reasons Why Jesus is Returning in 1988. Did anybody see that? Anybody remember that? There were people who were canceling doctor's appointments because Jesus was coming back. One guy canceled the contractor he had coming to pour his driveway because Jesus was coming back and he didn't need to have that work done and he didn't need to spend that money. And you know what happened? When Jesus didn't come back on the date that was promised, that guy got really mad. Because when he called that contractor to come pour his driveway again, he went way down at the bottom of the list. Jesus never said, God never told us, spend all your time studying, researching, reading people's opinions to try to figure out when I'm coming back. Instead, what he said time and time again is, be busy about the work, so when I come, I find you working. If somebody stands up and tells you Jesus is coming back on this date, here is the scriptural answer to that. Ignore them. No man knows the day. No man knows the hour. Only God the Father knows that. And when he says to his son, go get your children, that's when it happens. There is no advance notice. There's not going to be any warning to put it on our calendar. As a matter of fact, we're told it's going to come at a day and hour that no one knows and no one expects. And that's what these verses are talking about. If you knew that a criminal was planning to break into your house at 12:30 this afternoon, you know it. Are you going to just leave the house and say, well, they can take whatever they want? Or are you going to defend your house? Are you going to call your friends? Are you going to call the police? Are you going to set up a barrier to make sure you can protect the stuff that you have? Jesus said, if the owner knew when the thief was coming, he'd stop it. He wouldn't let it happen. But that's not how this world works. Can you imagine what a world it would be if the fire department knew ahead of time where the fires were going to be started and when they were going to be started? Then they could just go to those sites and put them out immediately before danger gets worse. Medical emergencies. Wouldn't it be great if you knew, well, I'm going to have a stroke in 15 minutes, so let me go ahead and get the medical personnel here to take care of me. But that's not how it works. And what about car accidents or other accidents? We don't know when they're going to happen. So we trust that people will be ready at all times. You know, one of the big things right now has been this emphasis from some people saying to defund the police. And for some people, they're saying just cut out police altogether. Let's just use social workers. And then there's others who are saying we don't want to do away with police entirely, but we do want to take a lot of the money and focus it in different directions to help communities. But can you imagine if you were to call the police department and say, somebody's trying to break into my house, and they were to say, well, we'll send somebody over to talk to them and see if they can give them some common sense and move away from your property and just go back to their own place. It doesn't work, does it? We're living in a world where we want to have solutions that work the way we want them to work. But it doesn't always happen that way. We don't know what's going to happen. So we have to live each moment in faith, and we have to be prepared at all times. In verse 40, it says, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. I like to say, when you least expect it. When you least expect it, Jesus is going to come back. You know, I've said before, what if Jesus came back on Super Bowl Sunday? He'd find a whole lot more people packed into his stadium than he would in churches. What if Jesus came back just before kickoff of the Alabama-Auburn game? Wow. We don't know when he's going to come back. But the point is this, we get so caught up in the things that we love, the things that bring us joy, the things we're excited about, that we forget the greatest thing that should bring us joy is the fact that Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is coming back for us. Doesn't that get you excited?
To me, the greatest thing in the world is to know that Jesus loves me, that Jesus died for me, Jesus has saved me, he's forgiven me, and one day he's coming back for me. With all my sins, with all my mistakes, with all the times I fail to obey him, he still loves me, his grace extends, and he has a place for me. And someday when he comes to take me to that place, here's the thing I love. No more sickness. I've suffered from chronic migraines since I was 18 years old. I'm 55 today. I still have them. Just about every day of my life, I have some level of head pain. I'm not going to have that in heaven. To look at me walk, you wouldn't know that I've had 20 orthopedic surgeries on my knees. I've got 2 artificial knees right now. In heaven, I'm going to be able to dance. And one other thing. In heaven, I believe there's going to be Krispy Kreme donuts. They're not going to have calories because we're not going to be fat. This fat body will be thin and healthy in heaven because it's going to be a perfected heavenly body. And that's something to look forward to. But what we've got to understand is we can't just sit back in a rocking chair and say, I'm saved. I'm just going to sit here and wait for Jesus to come get me. No, Jesus said, until I come, you've got work to do. Just like my parents told us, we're going away temporarily, but we're coming back. And we've given you work to do. So before we get back, you better complete these jobs. Now, it's interesting here. Jesus gives all these instructions, puts them out very clearly to the disciples. But as usual, there's a question. And in verse 41, Peter said, Lord, are you telling this parable for us or for all? Are you telling this parable for us or for all? Who is this message for? And I love how Jesus always answers with a question. Jesus responded, who then is the faithful and wise manager whom his master will set over his household to give them their portion of food at the proper time? So Peter's saying, Lord, is this message for us, the disciples, those of us who follow you, those of us who are already with you? Or is this for every person? Now, let's think about that. Is it for every person? Does every person in the world need to know that Jesus is coming back? Absolutely. Does every person need to hear the gospel? Is every person either saved or unsaved? Yes. So, yes, the message is for all people, but Jesus went on to say this. Identify your place in this story. Who is the faithful and wise manager? Are you just a servant of God, or are you a faithful and wise manager? What's the difference between the two? The difference between the two is this. First of all, neither one of them is the owner. They simply work for the owner. We don't own anything in this world. Everything we have belongs to God, and we are stewards of what he has given us. But how seriously do we take that stewardship? You see, servants sometimes just do the bare minimum to get by. But the manager takes what the owner gives him and treats it as though it is his very own. And he does the best he can with it, and he uses all of his strength, all of his wisdom, all of his abilities to protect what's been placed in his care. And so Jesus answers the question with a question to say, well, are you just an ordinary servant? Or are you someone who's been entrusted with knowledge and gifts and skills to use for the owner's purposes? Jesus goes on and says, blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. So in essence, all Jesus is saying is, you make the decision. You choose to be a faithful and wise manager, or you choose to be an ordinary servant. But it's the faithful and wise manager who is given responsibility over all that the owner has, all that the master has. It goes on in verse 44 and says, truly I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions. You know, you don't start at the top in a job. You start at the bottom. And you're given a certain level of responsibility. And as you do more work, you earn trust. And the owner puts more faith in you and gives you more responsibility. And that's how it is in the kingdom of God. You don't start out and say, I trusted in Christ today, I'm going to be a preacher tomorrow. That's not how it works. Yeah, you can share your faith in Christ, but you got to be faithful with the little bit that God gives you. And as you are faithful, he will give you more and more. He'll give you more gifts. He'll give you more abilities. He'll give you more responsibility for his kingdom and his glory. On verse 45, Jesus says, "But if that servant says to himself, 'My master is delayed in coming,' and begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and get drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and put him with the unfaithful." In other words, if you have been given a responsibility by God, and you are irresponsible with it through your behavior, you're not doing the things he's told you to do, as a teacher would say, you're off task. It's usually because you've lost sight of the mission and purpose. And the entire reason for this message today is to remind all of us what our mission and purpose is. Jesus said that until he comes, you will receive power to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. God didn't call us here just to mark time waiting for him to come back. He called us to be his hands and feet. He called us to be his witnesses. He called us to take the gospel to the ends of the earth, and that starts right here where we are right now. In verses 47 and 48, it says, "And that servant who knew his master's will but did not get ready or act according to his will receive a severe beating. But the one who did not know and did what deserved a beating will receive a light beating." Now, a lot of people struggle with that and say, "I don't understand. It's talking about Jesus coming back and some of his followers getting a severe beating and some of them getting a light beating. I don't like that. I don't like the idea of Jesus giving us a beating." Think of it this way. I started off with the example of my dad. And if we didn't do things the way he told us to do when he came home, we got disciplined. For those who clearly understood the instructions and completely disobeyed them, it was a worse paddling. But for the ones who didn't quite understand as much, it wasn't as bad. Here's the thing. Dad disciplined us, but he didn't kick us out of the family. This is not saying that you lose your salvation. Because when you have put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, he holds you firmly in his hand and nobody can pull you away. When you're saved, you're saved. But understand that when you're saved, you're part of the family and the Father has the right to do whatever he wants to with you. He can send you where he wants you to go. He can tell you what he wants you to do. And if you choose not to do it, he can discipline you. Now, do I think when we get to heaven, we're going to get beatings? No, I don't. What I think this means is, we're going to be rewarded according to the effort we put forth in his work. And there are some who are going to be faithful and they're going to receive greater rewards. And there are some who are not as faithful and they may receive lesser rewards. But we're all still God's family. We're all still forgiven by his grace and his sacrifice. And we're all going to gather and worship him in the glory of heaven. Keith Green years ago wrote a song that said this: "The world is sleeping in the dark, and the church just can't fight because we're asleep in the light. How can we be so dead when we've been so well fed? Jesus rose from the grave, and you can't even get out of bed." I feel like we've reached a day and age in the world where the church has fallen asleep on the job. God told us to proclaim the gospel until he comes. And if we long for his return, we need to be busy preaching his word. We need to be demonstrating the love of Jesus Christ every day, everywhere we are, telling people the difference that God can make in their lives. This parable teaches that rewards are in accordance to our responsibility. I've heard people say for years in the United States that with the freedom we have here in the United States also comes responsibility. And if we don't practice responsibility, we will lose those freedoms. I had a teacher in elementary school who used the phrase, "If you abuse it, you lose it." She would give us certain times where if we were behaving, she'd give us a break and we'd have a game time. Or we'd have a free reading period. Or she'd take us outside just to get out of the classroom for a little while. But if we got out there and we were messing around and we were not following her instructions, She'd take away the reward just as quickly as we got it. If you abuse it, you lose it. I want to close with this in verse 48. It says this: Everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. And from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more. Everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. Has God given you much? I want you to think about this. Has God given you salvation? Has God given you forgiveness? Has God extended to you mercy? Has God extended to you grace time and time again? Do you have a house to live in? Do you have a job? Do you have a car? How many of you walked here today? You have a car that God blessed you with. Do you have clothes? I don't see anybody naked out here this morning. All this is to say everything we have comes from the hand of God. And in the United States of America, what we need to understand is we have greater religious freedom here than anywhere else in the world. And along with that religious freedom comes a responsibility. We have ways we can bless the world through mission efforts that other nations can't do, other congregations in other countries can't do. Because God has blessed us with freedom, we've got to take responsibility and use that freedom to share the gospel and build his kingdom. From him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand much more. Until Jesus comes, we are called to be witnesses to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So this morning, I want you to bow your heads in prayer as we close this time of the message and prepare for a time of invitation. Would you close your eyes and just answer these three questions? Number one, are you saved? Are you saved? Because everyone in this world is either lost or they're saved. There's no in between. There's no middle ground. There's no fence. If you're saved, I pray that you would take that calling, that responsibility seriously. If you're not saved, I pray today might be the day you would put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. The second question is this: are you serving? Are you serving? If you're saved, you should be serving. God sent his Spirit to you. God has empowered you to serve. And many of our churches are filled with people who want to be spectators and not servants. God didn't call us to be spectators. He didn't call us to sit on the bench. He called us to be active and ready for service. And that means every person, no matter what age you are, there is some way you can serve in his kingdom. Are you serving? And the third question: are you longing for his return? Are you longing for his return? You know, sometimes I think we're more excited about upcoming football season than we are about the return of Jesus. We're more excited about hunting season than we are about the upcoming return of Jesus. We get so distracted by the things of this world. But as a Christian, this world is not our home. We're longing to go home, and our home is in heaven. Are you longing for his return? If not, pray that God would restore that passion, that excitement, that enthusiasm for his return. Father, as we come to you this morning, we simply ask that we would measure our readiness. You didn't call us to look at anybody else. You called us to look at ourselves and say, are you ready? May each one of us today ask the question, are we ready for the coming of the Lord? Are we ready and busy as though it could happen at any time? Are we passionate in sharing the gospel? And are we passionate about your coming? Father, draw the lost to you this morning. Give the saved a passion to be ready to serve now. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand together and have our closing song. The altar's open for prayer. Mason's going to be here at the front if you'd like to come and make a public decision. Would you follow the Lord's leading this morning as we sing?
As you are, be just as you are. Come and see, come receive, come and live forever. Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit.
We're so glad that y'all joined us today, and what I want to do is I want to pray for us real fast, and then we are free to go. So let's pray. God, thank you so much for Pastor Danny's word today. Thank you so much for Larry and the band. Thank you for teaching us just what it means to love you. God, I pray that we have learned something today and that you've touched our hearts, and I pray that we will take what we've learned today and we will use it in the community and we will teach other people about what we've learned. Help us to just continue to love other people the way you would love them. In your name we pray, amen.
He goes before me. He goes before me.